Flying Scotsman. Two words that describe what was once the most famous steam engine in the world. It was powerful. It was elegant. It was full of romance.
That's very emotional.
But most of all, it was fast. It was really fast.
When one of the drivers first saw it in 1923, he called it colossal.
And even when steam went out of fashion, amazing acts of generosity and kindness kept it running, so millions of people, including me, could still appreciate it.
What kind of reception were you getting when you arrived in, say, New York or Boston?
We had crowds, didn't we? Yeah.
We had about 3,000 people in Philadelphia. It was really quite remarkable.
But then a while back, Flying Scotsman disappeared. Lost to generations of admirers. So I'm on a quest to find out what happened to this icon of engineering that changed so many people's lives.
Including mine.
This is how Flying Scotsman, once the most famous steam engine in the world, used to look. And I'm sure most of you, like me, thought it had died, gone for good. Or it was like this sorry-looking character here, just rusting away to nothing. Well, it's still alive. Just. And I can tell you where it is. It's lying in bits in this workshop behind me. It's been out of action for the last 10 years, but now a team of highly skilled engineers are finally bringing it back to life.
Whenever you take any engine apart, it's still you're going back to how they used to do it back in the day.
It's just old-fashioned engineering. There's no fancy computers to help you out. You've got to think for yourself, and you've got to plan your jobs yourself.
And this extraordinary team are going to let another old-fashioned engineer, me, give them a hand.
It's an enormous challenge. But if they succeed, Flying Scotsman will once again be travelling across the country for everyone to see. And they've promised me the chance of a lifetime to ride in the cab. So, we better get going.
It's February. And Flying Scotsman's owners, the National Railway Museum, want their flagship engine up and running by the end of the year. So for the men in this workshop near Manchester, the pressure is really on.
Do you feel as though you're awakening a sleeping giant?
Yeah, to bring the beast alive again, it'd be fantastic. To actually have a chuffing again would be something really magical.
I love the fact that you said, have it up, chuffing again. It's not running, it's chuffing, isn't it?
Chuffing, yeah.
To get Flying Scotsman chuffing again, they've had to strip the engine right back to bare essentials. Some parts were so bad they were beyond repair, like this front section.
And is this basically a whole new front end?
Yep, from there onwards, all brand new. Old piece, new piece. That's your weld in the middle.
You welded the front end of Flying Scotsman on yourself?
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, my first job is a bit less complicated. I'm helping Nick to weld a new pan that sits under the engine and collects ash from the fire.
Now, believe it or not, Nick, before I put on makeup and started poncing about in front of a camera, I did do a bit of welding in my time.
Right.
Swan Hunter shipbuilders. I am, but I soon realised that if British shipbuilding and I were to survive, we would have to part. I became an actor, to my father's annoyance.
More practice, the better.
You know when I'm fly fishing?
Yeah.
And I cast a fly?
That's the best rhythm.
Wait for it to flip.
Yeah. So is it the same with welding? Is there a rhythm to it?
Yep, exactly that.
And that's the end of my first day. But I'll be back to help them with the next big job in the spring, when they put it back on its wheels. What's impressed me most is how devoted this young team are in getting Flying Scotsman up and running again. But you have to ask yourself, why do it?
Well, to me, Flying Scotsman symbolizes something that changed all our lives, you know, nearly 200 years ago. Steam was basically the midwife to the birth of modern Britain. And you know what? It all started in my backyard. But I want to know how and why. So I'm going home to find out. I was born and brought up in these parts. And believe it or not, at one time, this place here was the largest coal field in the world. This area fired and fueled the Industrial Revolution.
We're talking about the early years of the 19th century. Industries were hungry for coal from Durham, but the coal was in the middle of the countryside, miles from where it was needed. In other parts of Britain, canals were used as transport, but a local coalfield engineer called George Stevenson and his son Robert realized that canals were yesterday's technology. They came up with something new.
The technology of steam. You can see how revolutionary it was. Don't get me wrong, a canal boat could pull a huge amount of coal, but they were slow. A steam engine, even one like this, could pull 20 to 30 wagons at a time. But it was fast. They were really fast. Permission to come on board? Do you want me in?
No, you're that. You're fine.
There's
you. Yeah, there's nice background there.
Nice background. You and your lavender. Oi! Right, let's all calm down.
George and Robert Stevenson first showed off their steam engine almost 200 years ago on a new railway line they built from near here to Stockton, a port on the River Tees.
Nobody'd seen anything quite like it. People climbed on board and passenger train journeys began. But it was that very first journey, here in the northeast of England, that changed the world forever. And over the decades, steam railways stretched right across Britain and the world. And steam engines, they just got bigger and faster. Until the Roaring Twenties, when they built the biggest and fastest of them all. They were called A1 Pacifics. How did they do it? Well, I'm heading south to Yorkshire to find out.
Hopefully, the answer lies here, in this Doncaster workshop, where Flying Scotsman was first built in 1923. In those days, the plant employed more than 10,000 people.
Is this you as an apprentice?
Yes.
So, how old are you here, Peter?
I'd probably be about 18.
Mm-hmm. So who designed Flying Scotsman?
Flying Scotsman was designed by Sir Nigel Gresley. It was H.N. Gresley at the time, but he was knighted in the 30s. He became chief mechanical engineer of the newly formed LNER in 1923, at a young age of 43, I think it was.
Peter has a collection of rare company books and photographs he was given 75 years ago.
Now, this is a photograph taken in the early 1900s of this environment. Something springs out immediately. There's a lot of health and safety issues here, Peter.
Oh, yes. I'm afraid nobody ever provided goggles or safety glasses or safety boots, anything like that.
Were you allowed ear defenders?
Sorry.
You answered my question. You answered my question.
I'm deaf.
Really? Was it because of that environment?
Yeah, I think because it's absolutely noisy. Everybody bashing and clanging. And when you worked in the boiler shop, it's absolutely terrible.
Was it a good place to work?
Madhouse.
This madhouse produced the biggest steam engines in Britain. Gresley had seen these six-wheel giants in America and wanted them for his express service from London to Scotland and the North. The 6-foot-8-inch driving wheels were bigger than the biggest man. The sheer size of these 95-ton heavyweights gave them the power to travel at speeds of 80 to 90 miles an hour. One was given the same name as the flagship railway service from King's Cross to Edinburgh, Flying Scotsman.
So, Flying Scotsman was a fast train, but they were faster.
No.
But Flying Scotsman is probably the most famous train in the world because everybody remembers the name. Why was it so special?
Well, just let me correct you on one point. Flying Scotsman is not a train.
Sorry, I beg your pardon. It's a locomotive. It's a steam engine.
The train
I keep making
is
that
what
mistake. I know, I'm sorry.
But, that's all right.
I'm sorry.
It's an Americanism that it's a train.
I beg your pardon.
In England, it's a locomotive.
No, I stand corrected. I'm sorry, I'm being told off by Peter.
But what was the question?
The question, sorry.
The question was, why did Flying Scotsman become so famous? That's what I'll be finding out after we've put it back on its wheels. These people have a massive challenge on their hands. They're rebuilding the world's most famous steam engine, Flying Scotsman. I've been with them for the last 4 months, and today's a big day. We're going to fit the boiler and the cab and lift it back on its wheels. First job is to help put a new steel tire on a wheel.
So we are going to put a tire on the wheel of a locomotive.
We are now.
I never knew locomotives had tires.
A lot of people don't know that.
Yeah.
Modern locomotives don't have solid wheels, but the old-fashioned ones have tires on.
Dave is testing the temperature. He needs to heat up the tyre to make it expand.
And how much is it going to expand by?
It'll expand that by 5 millimetres.
Five?
Yeah.
Then I'll drop the wheel into the tyre, and as it cools, it'll contract and grip the wheel. Well, that's the plan anyway.
If this goes wrong, can we do it again?
No.
We've only got one hit.
One hit, and that's it. And if it all goes wrong, you've got the controls.
Oh, it's my fault,
yeah,
is it?
Yes.
Yeah.
No, it'll be fine. Everything'll be fine. That should be all right, that. Right. I'll turn the gas off. Right, call ya.
Right. Believe it or not, we've only got one go at this.
Right, if you go down slowly now, please. Okay, go on. What? That's it, go on. Keep
go
going
on.
Down.
Is she on?
Yeah. Right, that's it. That's in. Man on every wheel, please! Right, we're just pushing up a little bit.
Too far. Go back a bit.
Right,
Don't move that wheel set unless it's foul now, because you're moving the entire chassis at the front. Well, look at that. That's precision engineering at its finest, that, isn't it?
Instinctively, can you tell a good engineer from a bad one?
Yeah. Some of the best lads in here are lads that haven't done... I can't read, all right? So I came into here, doing engineering with my hands. You know, at school, I did struggle with it. But when you come into an environment like this, you know, there's a purpose for it. You think, right, well, I need to learn to do that now. I need to do this, you know. And you've got lads that they can apply themselves, and not just apply themselves, and they actually put the effort in. And when you've got lads that can do that, they can achieve out.
Is she safe?
Yes, pegged.
Pegged?
It's pegged.
Now it's looking more like a steam engine. But there's no let up. The team are not even halfway there. Their goal's an ambitious one. To restore Flying Scotsman to the world-famous status its original designer, Nigel Gresley, would have been proud of.
Just how did the son of a Midlands clergyman turn a colossal steam engine into a household name? Well, believe it or not, the answer lies among the beautiful North York moors.
Now, this part of the journey gets personal for me, because in the 1920s, Flying Scotsman came into my family in Northumberland in dramatic fashion.
In 1926, millions of workers up and down the country stopped work in support of striking coal miners. Those in Northumberland were led by a member of my family.
My middle name is Golightly, and I get it from my great-grandfather, William Golightly, who was president of the NUM for Northumberland. And during the 1926 strike, he gave a speech, and he told the miners to stop the wheels turning. He meant the wheels of industry. What he didn't mean were the wheels of a very famous steam engine. Well, a group of striking miners lifted a rail to stop a train that they thought was pulling coal. What they didn't know, that train was Flying Scotsman. And sadly, it derailed. Luckily, no one was killed, but a group of seven miners were jailed for nearly 7 years. They wanted William Golightly to support them, to help their cause, but William distanced himself from them and what they stood for. And so the name Golightly is dirt in the Northumberland coalfield.
But it wasn't only my great-grandfather's reputation that suffered in 1926. That terrible incident left Flying Scotsman's image horribly stained, and it took Nigel Gresley 2 years to restore it.
Bob, nice what a magnificent-looking machine.
Yeah, it is great. Shall we get on the train? Because I think they're going to go soon.
Absolutely.
Cheers.
Travelling in style.
Bob Gwynn from the National Railway Museum is going to show me how Gresley used the tender, the part of the engine that carries coal and water, to transform Flying Scotsman from a PR disaster into a PR triumph.
So, I mean, a horrendous incident. It could have killed a lot of people, but obviously really negative imagery for Flying Scotsman. So how do you turn that adversity into a triumph?
Well, obviously this was their principal service. This was the train they were known for that goes from London to Edinburgh. And they decide what they're going to do is they're going to run it non-stop from London to Edinburgh. Never been done before. This is kind of a world first. The time of the train was 8 hours, 15 minutes, and technically it was possible to do it. The problem was the men could only work an 8-hour day.
So how do you overcome that, Bob?
Well, I'll show you. Follow me.
Where are we going?
onto the engine.
Hey, is this safe, Bob?
Oh, it's perfectly safe.
Oh, I see, that's how we did it. So Gresley designed a corridor in the tender so the relief crew could walk onto the footplate without the engine having to stop.
So basically, those firemen and the drivers did their 8-hour day and then they just swap over, but that ingenious invention there.
That's right.
Gresley was a genius. It seems so simple. I tell you what, this thing here, it gives you sight and it gives you sound. What you're not getting is the heat. Man's like a sauna. Woo!
I got steam heat, I got...
8 years after that historic non-stop run, Flying Scotsman clocked 100 miles an hour. To keep away the cold. Another world first. Steam heat, I got... With its cocktail bar, hairdressing salon, and fine dining, it was the last word in luxury travel. But I need your love to keep away the cold. A legend in its own lifetime.
But as we all know, nothing good ever lasts. Nigel Gresley himself was moving on, and Flying Scotsman was overtaken by a new class of even more powerful engines.
And when war was declared in 1939, speed was forgotten. Flying Scotsman, like every other steam engine, was painted black and put to work on the war effort. Then, in 1948, the railways were nationalised. With a booming car industry breathing down its neck, British Railways had a plan to modernise the system. Diesel and electric trains were seen as the future, while steam engines, even the world's most famous steam engine, were to be scrapped. Flying Scotsman's date with destiny was set for late 1962.
Now, you might have thought that the final chapter of this glorious story had been written. You might have thought that, but you'd be wrong.
My quest to find out what happened to Flying Scotsman has brought me to the beautiful hills of Snowdonia in North Wales.
Penny. Penny, hello, Robson.
Oh, Robson.
I feel as though I'm in a strange version of Brief Encounter.
Love the steam engine, sir.
Brilliant.
How are you? Good to meet you. Beautiful setting, beautiful steam train. What has all this got to do with Flying Scotsman?
Oh, well, I'll tell you about that on the train.
Okay.
Come on.
Penny is the daughter of Alan Pegler. Alan sadly died in 2012, but he will always be remembered as a real champion of steam. He first became involved with saving railways in the early 1950s, here on the Festiniog in North Wales. It was a time when British Railways wanted to modernise everything. Sweep away loss-making lines and the steam engines that ran on them.
My father was passionate about steam trains, and when they visited this with a group of friends at the beginning of the 50s and they saw this completely derelict but beautiful area, they felt that it was like their mission in life to save this railway.
So when in February 1963 British Rail decided to scrap the Scotsman, Alan had the audacity to pay £3,000 to save it.
He heard at the last hour that Scotsman was going to be demolished. I was 9 years old, and he walked into my room with a little springy stirrup and a twinkle in his eye, and he sat down and he said, "Today I bought a steam engine."
Wow.
And he said, "I'm going to have her painted apple green. She's called Flying Scotsman, and she was going to be demolished, cut up into little pieces, and so I felt I had to save her." In fact, I have a photo of the very first trip with her.
Now that is what you call a head turner, isn't it? Never mind your Ferrari or your Lamborghini. Alan Pegler's got Flying Scotsman. Look at that.
That is happiest.
Yeah, but also he's just going, this is right.
She should never be left to decay and die. She's a living, breathing thing that everyone should enjoy, you know.
When I bought the Scotsman, I had this idea, which apparently it was completely revolutionary thinking. It didn't occur to me that it was. I said, you know, I'd like to keep the engine running. And the immediate reaction was, well, you can't do that. You can't have a private engine running around on a nationalised railway. To which I replied, why not?
So what did your father do with the engine? Where did he take her?
He travelled with her all over England, really. And it was all filmed by a great friend of his, Terry Robinson, and she became part of our lives.
Looks good, doesn't she?
Looks good. It's a wonderful sight.
Yes, you know, when I was a boy, I spent a lot of time waving to railway engines, but they were always so busy they never bothered to wave back.
Sad for you.
Yeah.
That's how I looked when I first saw Flying Scotsman all those years ago in the 70s.
Did you?
Yeah, I was on a school trip to Edinburgh, and we just pulled into Edinburgh Station, and there she was on the other side, and we were aghast, and the teacher wanted us to come up. She went, come on, we've got a trip to go on. We went, no, we want to see that. So actually, half of the school trip was abandoned so we could actually look around Flying Scotsman. We weren't allowed on it.
No.
And, well, hopefully that kind of scenario will be fulfilled, because when she's complete, maybe I will get on her.
Yeah, absolutely.
And after 1968... I couldn't even see it anymore. That year, British Rail finally killed off all steam in Britain. So Alan Pegler upped sticks and took the Scotsman across the pond.
Have a really solid Tennessee excursion.
Pardon me, boy. And he didn't just take the engine. He took the whole kit and caboodle, the carriages and the blessing of the then Prime Minister, Harold Wilson. He wanted to show the Americans the best of British. So, he had the best of British on board. Watney's Beer, BP, and the Royal Shakespeare Company. It was all rounded off with a bunch of beautiful ladies. And 50 years on, I'm going to meet two of them for a cup of tea and a chat.
How did you get involved in something like this? Well, did you have to take an exam or apply, or was there an interview?
Just an interview.
I had to go and have an interview to make sure I'm not like the back of one of the London buses.
So come on, what qualifications did you need to be on board?
Personality, I think, just sort of.
Well, I'll
be
never
a fun
know
loving,
how they chose us because each girl.
I'm telling you, I know exactly why they chose you. It doesn't take an Oxford don to work out why you lot were chosen to go on the Flying Scotsman. Yeah. Come on.
No, fantastic.
Well, we're all so different.
Yeah. You know. Any red-blooded male will look at that and go, they're right for the job. What were you guys known as collectively?
Trade promotion girls.
Trade promotion girls.
We didn't do much promoting, really. We just
we tried to sell the souvenirs.
Was there two red London buses on board?
There were two London buses.
What was that about?
Well, they converted them into like sort of boutiques so that we could sell the souvenirs. That's Anna there.
Yeah.
And that's me there, hanging on to the bus.
And what kind of reception were you getting when you arrived in, say, New York or Boston or Texas?
Everybody wanted to get to know us.
We had crowds, didn't we?
We had about 3,000 people in Philadelphia. Everybody wanted to get to know you. Every time you went into a different town, you'd pull in. The girls, there were about 10 of us girls in mini kilts, white boots, tam-o-shanters.
They thought we were Scottish. They thought we were genuinely Scottish. The Americans loved all that, didn't they?
They loved razzmatazz.
Was it like one big party you never wanted to end?
Yes, absolutely.
Don't tell our husbands it was the first time of our life.
There's going to be a certain party at the station.
Certainly.
I used to call funny face.
So how do you feel about the fact that Flying Scotsman's being rebuilt?
Oh, I think it's wonderful. Will she go out on the
tracks? Oh, she's going to go out on the tracks. Oh, yeah, she's under a full head of steam. Oh, yeah.
Well, we might get a job.
Well, if that's what they think about the Scotsman's return, I can only imagine what Alan Pegler's daughter must be feeling.
So when was the last time you saw a Flying Scotsman?
Years ago.
Yeah? Well, next week I'm with a group of guys, amazing engineers, who are getting her back to her former glory. Would you like to join me?
I'd love to. Wonderful. Real treat.
Good. It's a date.
She's gonna cry until I tell her that I'll never roam.
So, Chattanooga choo-choo.
Won't you choo-choo me home?
Chattanooga, Chattanooga.
Get aboard.
Chattanooga, Chattanooga. All aboard.
It's July, and today I'm helping Colin Green fix these pipes. They'll take high-pressure steam from the boiler and push the pistons round. So the seals have to be exact.
That's it. That's perfect, isn't it? Right. In the water.
Water.
In the cement.
So this is fire cement, and it won't deteriorate or crack when extreme temperatures are applied to it, yeah?
Yeah, it'll sit there quite happily. We'll just fill this cavity now with a sausage.
Fill which one?
Just if you put it on top of that cement.
Certainly.
And then it'll all ooze together. That's it. That's perfect. Yes. Have you done this before?
Oh, mate. I'm wasted as an actor. Or some people might say you're wasting your time as an actor.
OK.
So once they come together, that'll just squeeze the cement?
That'll line up with in there.
That's perfect there.
Right, let's get a nut and a washer on that.
So I'm just thinking what you guys have achieved and what's relatively a short space of time. She's going to be just as good as she was in 1923.
I'm hoping she's going to be better.
This is proper work. I love it. How's that?
That's lovely.
Strange to think, isn't it, that when Flying Scotsman is eventually running, someone will ring me up and say, I saw Flying Scotsman today. And I'll say, oh, yeah. You know the main steam pipe glands? I helped fit those.
Sorted. Now I've got a date to keep.
Hey, Penny. Good to see you again.
Hello, good to see you. Fine.
Come with me. Are you ready for this?
Yes, I'm ready.
It's been a while since you last saw Flying Scotsman. Just look down to the ground. Don't look up.
I look down to the ground.
Yeah.
Not going to cheat.
Nearly there. Colin Green and his team have done an amazing job. Keep looking down.
I'm looking down.
Okay.
Gonna take a sentimental.
So I'm just gonna stand you over here.
My heart.
Just keep your eyes down.
There.
Yeah. Okay. Now look up.
To renew old memories.
That's very emotional.
Got my back. Got my
judging by your reaction, Penny. Flying Scotsman was obviously a big part of your life, eh?
Oh, Flying Scotsman was a very important part of my life.
So you were on the third tour of America on Flying Scotsman.
I was on the third tour, yes.
That all aboard.
Come on, let's get up. Come on, ladies first.
You see, I would come through the corridor tender, which isn't there today.
Look at you, you know where to sit, don't you?
This was my seat.
Was it?
Yeah.
How about you and your dad just had a permanent smile on your face during the trip,
yes,
wasn't
we
it?
Did. It wasn't such a smile at the very, very end, but...
I know.
I can understand why Penny stopped smiling. Flying Scotsman was heading for the deepest crisis of its roller coaster life. Running the engine around the USA was hugely expensive, and Penny's father simply ran out of money. He ended the 1970 tour with debts of £130,000.
So towards the end of the tour, were you aware that your father was hemorrhaging money to the point of bankruptcy?
No. I knew things were getting difficult, but I didn't know to what extent. We did, in fact, lose absolutely everything. But we were never cross about it. That's the way it was. Daddy had, you know, he'd saved this incredible engine, and we'd had a wonderful time in the States. We had no regrets. My father had certainly, absolutely no regrets. And nor did I.
Why did I? Alan Pegler was declared bankrupt in 1972. He had to work his passage back to England, while Flying Scotsman was left marooned in an army base near San Francisco, with no prospect of ever coming home.
Sentimental journey home.
Everyone thought that was the end of it. How could Flying Scotsman possibly survive this? Well, to find out how she did, I'm heading south to the beautiful Chiltern Hills.
I've been travelling across the country finding out how Flying Scotsman became the nation's favourite steam engine and how it survived so many crises in its illustrious life. Today, I've come to the Chiltern Hills to hear how one man's passion rescued it from mortal danger across the Atlantic.
Now, after Alan Pegler lost absolutely everything, the engine was stranded in America. It was locked up in a Californian army base, out of sight and, well, for most people, out of mind. But there was one man whose thoughts very rarely strayed from this icon of engineering. And thanks to him, the story of Flying Scotsman was given a new chapter. The man who saved her, Sir William McAlpine.
I'll be honest with you, I've never come across a place quite like this. Got a train station, along with a steam engine.
Good morning, Sir William.
Good morning.
How are you?
Very well, thanks.
Robson Green, pleasure to meet you.
Pleasure to meet you too.
Sir William, may I call you Bill?
Please do.
Bill, you're the first person I've ever met who's got a steam engine in their back garden. Are you addicted to steam engines?
Oh, definitely an addiction, I would say. Yeah. I was interviewed once by a fellow and he said, in Sweden we call people like you transsexuals. He said he's not sure whether it's substitution or sublimation.
So tell me your involvement in the saving of Flying Scotsman.
I didn't want it, actually. But
really?
Well, I already had a locomotive. Well, I was approached as somebody said it's in trouble in the States and we ought to do something about it. So we should get together and see what we can do, you know, raise some money and so on. You couldn't allow the thing to rot in America. I mean, basically, I've decided that it ought to be bought for the nation, really, but bought for the people who loved her, I think is the way to put it.
So in January 1973, the reluctant hero dug deep in his wallet and paid $72,000 to bring Flying Scotsman home.
So, Bill, you brought number 31 engine to your back garden, and what did you do with 4472 when she came from America?
She started a career doing a bit of earning and went to the Dart Valley Railway, where she stayed for several months. And we were asked to take her to Australia to celebrate the bicentennial. The original idea was to have a locomotive from each continent.
Had you not have intervened, Bill, what do you think would have happened to Flying Scotsman?
Oh, she would have ended up in the States and as a restaurant or something. We couldn't really risk that. She had to come home.
Yeah, a restaurant, that's not right.
No.
In your heart, did you feel Flying Scotsman should be here where she
was
born?
Oh, absolutely. She belongs here. She's a British icon, really, and loved by so many people. It's quite amazing.
Now, Bill McAlpine may not have wanted to buy Flying Scotsman in the first place, but he kept her for 23 years. He overhauled her twice and then sold her to yet another millionaire. And finally, she was bought by the National Railway Museum, and that's where Colin Green and his team of incredible engineers comes in.
It's late November, and I've been working with Colin and the team for nearly a year.
And now, she's almost finished. Isn't it, Terri-Ann?
Yeah.
Time to put a bit of paint on, yeah?
Yep.
Will you give me a lesson in painting steam engine?
Sure will.
Yeah?
It's not what people think. You just get a paintbrush and just paint it. It's actually harder than it looks.
Work it in. Just like that. And then lay it off downwards.
Terri-Ann, I take it this is the undercoat. Oh, God, I've gone over the number 5. Is that all right?
Yeah, it's all right, don't worry.
Have you got any turps?
It doesn't matter, doesn't it?
Oh, no, I've gone over the number.
It's only undercoat.
I'm so sorry.
It's all right, you won't do it.
It's your own fault, you brought me here.
It's okay.
We're all fallible, aren't we?
So how did this all come about? How did you end up working in an environment like this?
Well, it was some holidays. Me and my brother used to argue all the time, like, hit each other, just like brothers and sisters would do. And my mother got really sick of it because we'd never listen to her. We wouldn't do chores, we wouldn't do anything, just argue all the time. Eventually, my dad got sick of it when he came home from work. As a punishment, I got told, oh, you come to Bury, whether you like it or not. You're doing it, no arguments. If you don't like it, tough.
Well, this was a form of detention for you?
Yeah, it was sort of a detention, and I ended up enjoying it.
I tell you what, you and I have common ground, because I was put on detention at school. And when I was put on detention, what I did for my detention was stage fighting, and I loved it so much I became an actor. Mm. True story.
It feels good because I know when I go home I can speak to my granddad about it because he always asks me, how's your day been? And because he loves trains, so it brings me closer to my family. Yeah.
I mean, I'm just in awe of you guys, you know. I remember seeing this not so long ago and it was just in bits on the floor of this workshop.
Yeah.
And now look at her.
It's amazing.
When Flying Scotsman was first built in 1923, the cost was just over £8,000. This restoration has cost more than £4 million. Is it worth it? I think so.
You know, one of Britain's most famous scientists, if not the world's most famous scientist, Isaac Newton, he gave us laws of motion. And his first law of motion states that an object at rest remains at rest unless acted upon by an unbalanced force. And an object in motion continues in motion and in the same direction unless acted upon by an unbalanced force. And the latter part of that law, to me, loosely states, things that move like to move. And I think that applies to Flying Scotsman. Gresley created it and designed it to move. And thanks to these amazing engineers here, that's exactly what it's going to be doing again.
Today's the big day. My year with Flying Scotsman is almost over. Thousands have turned out on a wet January morning to see the legend return to the track for the first time in 10 years. A triumph for the people who made it happen.
When you've actually finished it and it's out there and it's in steam and you walk out and you stand back and you see it leave the shed, and that's our work. That's our achievement as a team.
Well, just when you thought it couldn't get any better, they've asked me to fire Flying Scotsman. People get to do this right on the footplate of the most famous steam engine in the world. You know, as an actor and presenter, all I've done during my career is help to tell a story. And the rebuilding of this icon of engineering by Colin Green and his amazing team of engineers is quite a tale. And it's one that inspires the imagination.
Not many people would turn around and say, oh, I helped rebuild the Flying Scotsman. Who else can do that?
It's a story of commitment, dedication, skill, and at its heart, love.
When I'm older, or
my daughter's older, it'll be my dad worked on Flying Scotsman, and that's the kind of thing that I will enjoy.
The rebirth of this locomotive legend is something that I think we as a nation should be incredibly proud of. So all good things must come to an end, but I've got a feeling the story of Flying Scotsman is one that will carry on for generations to come. Always wanted to do this. Oh, yeah.
When you hear the whistle blowing 8 to the 5, then you know that Tennessee is not very far.
Down the lava calling, gotta keep it rolling. Ooh, Jack, there you are.
There's gonna be a certain party at the station. I used to call Funny Face.
The very latest ITV news is coming up next. Tomorrow, mental and physical challenges abound in Bang on the Money at 7. Then the search goes on in Britain's Got Talent, that's at 8. At 9:20, Sports The Thing, Holly and Frank are joined by Anthony Joshua. Play to the whistle.